Hi, everybody. Welcome to today's show. We're going to talk about all of the top tips we can give you to give your application that extra boost. Now, there's lots of different sections within the UCAS application which you have to fill in. Many of those aren't necessarily within your control, things like your qualifications, reference, that sort of stuff. But there are other aspects that you can make your application even stronger and really make it sing based on the things that you can do. And these are things like extracurricular activities, work experience, etc. So we're going to go through those in a bit more detail and give you the best advice as to what you should be doing. Now, my name's Courtney Shepherd. I'll be chairing this session, hosting. And I've got two wonderful panelists joining me. I've got Amy Smith, who is the Associate Director of Admissions and Student Recruitment at Nottingham Trent University. And I've got Charlie Smith here, no relation, by the way, who is the Student Recruitment Manager at the University of Bath. So they've got lots and lots of experience about the UCAS application, enrolling students onto courses, selecting the right kinds of students. So you're in good hands, and I'll do my very best to facilitate that. Please pop your questions in the comments, though, and we'll get back to you and answer those questions as we go along. But let's get into this. So we're going to talk about today some work experience, do's and don'ts on that, summer schools. You may not know what a summer school is, but you will by the end of this session. Extracurricular activities, volunteering, the importance of the personal statement, and we'll also touch a bit about applying for an apprenticeship as well, because that's a little bit different to going through the UCAS application for a higher education course. So that's what we've got today. I'll dive into our questions to begin with, but like I say, please pop your questions in the comments and we'll get back to you as we go along. Okay, so we'll come to you first, Charlie. So can you approach anyone for work experience, I mean, anyone within a work experience context, or is there a set place where people need to go to look for vacancies, same for volunteering? Can you talk us a bit about why work experience for your university application?
So with work experience, it's something that students can do to strengthen their application, boost their application, and it can show us at universities that a student is really interested in the subject or the topic that they're applying for. Work experience can come in lots of different forms. It can be a very formal week that you go and do and you go through certain activities, or it can be really informal. It could be a friend that you know who works in a particular company or a particular organisation, and it could be an afternoon, or it could even be a meeting that you go along to and you just observe and you listen to what they do. So I think work experience is a sort of one-size-fits-all term for something which can come in lots of different forms. Some people might even do things like a sort of some mini internship over the summer. That could still be classed as work experience. In terms of sourcing work experience and getting work experience, there's lots of different ways you can do it. You can approach a local company, drop them an email, give them a call. Some employers will have sections on their website which will invite applications for work experience, and it will very much vary depending on the employer how you'll get the work experience and what that work experience will look like. I said it can vary quite significantly depending on the sector, the job, and also kind of where you live, unfortunately, as well.
Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing some advice for where students should go. Probably your school might have good links. It might be a first point.
Schools would be a great point. Your careers department in the school or your teachers, your subject teachers might have links to local businesses, local companies. Some schools have old boy networks and kind of alumni networks that may have places reserved for people from certain schools as well. There are, I think, some employers will also have sections on their website specifically for work experience. Mm-hmm. If you're looking at applying for a specific course, for example, accountancy, very specific degree with a very specific kind of end goal at the end of it, approach local accountancy firms. They will be able to kind of facilitate and support work experience. But also you can use Google, use other kind of generic ways to kind of search for the and find opportunities.
Yeah. I'm guessing what I'm getting from this, Charlie, is initiative. So you
absolutely
need to take some initiative yourself.
Here. Yeah, I think that's probably the big thing. It's showing a bit of oomph, a bit of drive to you as an individual student, taking the time to identify a relevant opportunity and then going to apply for it. Whether that be a formal application where you have to complete various forms, or it might just be a simple email, simple phone call to an employer and saying, can I do some work experience? And then come on board. Mm-hmm. And like I said, work experience comes in lots of different forms, but you as the individual student will be expected to pursue that. You very rarely will get work experience kind of offered to you on a plate.
Yeah.
So it is important that she takes the time to find relevant experience.
Yeah.
And I say relevant experience, it doesn't have to be specifically to the field that you're looking for. Could just be, you know, working in an accountancy firm. You go, actually, accountancy probably not the direction I want to travel. But you can kind of reflect on that in your personal statement. And if you say, I did work experience with the accountancy firm, realized actually I'm more interested in strategy, for example, for business, and that's the route I'm now applying for. That type of thing, it looks really good on a statement and really shows that not only the students done the work experience, but they've had the, I guess, the self-awareness to reflect on it and realize that that experience is shaped at a different path.
Mm. So we do have some recordings that you can go back to around the personal statement where we do bring out some of these things where you can emphasize why things like work experience is important. But Amy, coming to you, can you perhaps either some examples or reasons why something like work experience can stand a student in good stead for their application into higher education?
So there's a few reasons why work experience or just broader work in general, so not necessarily that very structured 1 or 2 weeks or the summer in a very specific course-related environment, but also, you know, part-time work and the skills and experience that you can gain from doing that. There's a few ways that it makes applications stand out. So one is that it's 100% personal to you. So if you've got work experience alongside your school or college experience, then there's no other person that will have had exactly the same experience as you. So it brings that personal statement back into being very specifically about you as an individual. And it's something that looks really good on your application from a both from an initiative point of view, but also an interest in the subject area and the skills and attributes that are required in order to study at university. So as I mentioned previously, part-time work in what you think may be an unrelated industry to the course area that you're interested in, you will still be gaining skills and experience that are helpful for university study. So it's being able to draw out that experience in your application form, and the personal statement is the place to do that for both formal work experience and part-time work or informal experience that you might have got as a result of talking to a company or talking to a friend or a parent or whoever it may be, to get that little bit of extra edge on your application that not everybody's going to have.
Mm-hmm. Lovely, thanks, Amy. So, Charlie, how does volunteering differ to work experience? Imagine many of the principles are the same.
Yeah, so volunteering tends to be something which is usually longer term. So somebody might volunteer one night a week, for example, at a local, care home, for example, and go in every Monday and help over the course of a year or longer period. Work experience tends to be kind of more condensed, but both are kind of valuable experience and evidence to draw upon in an application. Work experience, I think, will tend to be, as I said, shorter, a bit more concentrated. Volunteering, you might have a bit more responsibility, you might have a bit more your own kind of roles that you do as a volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
But they overlap quite a lot, and I think the experiences you draw from both can support an application, definitely.
Yeah. Okay, wonderful, thank you. So initiative there, I think, is the key point. Go out and find that for yourself, because it will look good on your UCAS application. It will look good if you're going for an apprenticeship as well. It will also look good on your CV in years to come when you go looking for more formal work. So next point here, we want to talk about summer schools. So Amy, if you wouldn't mind, could you just explain the term summer schools? What does it mean? And then any advice and points you have to follow on?
Yeah, so there are different definitions of summer schools or different ways that these are conducted. So some of them are things like residentials, where you go as a small group to stay at a university and experience perhaps taster lectures. You might do some other activities that are related to wider student life. They can be subject specific. So you might end up doing, let's say, a full week of art and design related activities or a full week of engineering related activities, and meeting academics, meeting current students, and getting that taste, if you like, of university life. That's the primary aim of a summer school, really, is to get that flavor and to get you interested in what it's like to be at university before you even start. They're offered by a wide range of universities for a wide range of different reasons. So subject specific, maybe one, high attainment, maybe another. So some universities target really high achieving students to get them onto their campuses and get them to see what university is like. There's also some outreach and widening participation related summer schools. So perhaps students in a particular area don't tend to go to certain universities. So they again will invite students to come to their summer school activities and or residentials. So it covers a wide range of activities that are held at a university for school and college students rather than for, let's say, first years.
Okay, cool. Thank you. Now, in terms of going to summer school, does it look good on the personal statement if you've been to a summer school?
It does, yeah. Again, it does show that initiative. So they're not mandatory. It's not essential that you go to a summer school. But if you do get that opportunity and take that opportunity, then it's something personal to talk about in your application. It gives you something to talk about at interviews as well. So if you are applying for courses that require an interview, you can talk about your summer school experience as part of that interview. So again, showing that you're interested in the subject, interested in the university, and interested in wider university study more broadly. But again, it all comes back to that personal experience and that part of the application that makes you you. So just adding in a line that says, I went to a summer school, won't stand out as much as I went to a summer school at University X, and these are the things that I learned and these are the things that I gained as experience from that summer school. So if you're going to include it in your application, really think about how you've benefited from it and how that relates to the courses that you're applying for.
And I think it's that experience that you get from a summer school which can either validate that university is the right thing for you, or you might think, hang on, this might not be okay, and you can pursue some alternate paths. We'll come on to apprenticeships in a second. So Charlie, Amy did reference that quite a lot of different universities put on summer schools. Mm-hmm. Where can somebody go to find out information on these?
So at Bath, use us as an example, we have specific web pages for each summer school. Different summer schools that we run have different entry requirements. Some you have to apply by a certain date as well. So university website's the first place to look, and that will give you all of the information that you need. And bearing in mind that you will often have to apply for those and go through a process. So understanding what you need to do, identifying those opportunities early will help. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I think if you are interested in going to a summer school, give yourself a lot of time to plan for that, because they might fill up and there might not be any places. So take some initiative yourself, go onto the university websites and have a look. Particularly, it might seem obvious, but the unis that you're interested in applying to, that would be really good. And then also speak to your school. Your teachers might have some networks which they've used in the past, but give yourself plenty of time for those, because as Charlie said, they are quite competitive and you may have to apply for them as well. Just because you're showing initiative doesn't mean that you'll get it. Mm. All right, so next we'll just touch briefly about apprenticeships, because there's a lot of information and advice around there about apprenticeships, as you can go into an apprenticeship as opposed to university. You can earn whilst you learn, but the application process is somewhat different at the moment. So, Amy, just in summary, could you tell us, are the apprenticeship applications the same as a UCAS application? And do they follow the same sorts of deadlines? Or is it something different entirely?
So the short answer to that question is, unfortunately, no. But I'll give a little bit of context around that. So at NTU, we've got 22 different degree apprenticeships. We've got about 1,500 apprentices on those courses. And the application process overall is very similar for all of those 22 courses. So there is an application form that you need to fill out that it's, they all start in the same way. So with personal details, you have to add a statement, you may have to add a reference, you can upload supporting information, there's apprenticeship forms that you need to fill out. The deadlines for each one of those are different. So it depends on when the company that is supporting that apprenticeship needs to have all of their apprentices in place. So you'll need to check on both UCAS Career Finder to look at the different opportunities that are available, but then also individual university websites, again, to see what apprenticeships are available at that university and what the dates and deadlines are. You may be invited to an interview. That doesn't always happen, but it depends, again, what sort of industry you're wanting to go into as an apprenticeship. And then there are various requirements that you need to meet, including but not limited to getting your A-levels and your other qualifications. So just because you're coming to do a degree apprenticeship doesn't mean that your level 3 qualifications don't matter. You know, there will still be entry requirements in order to get onto that apprenticeship. I've already mentioned references, but then there's also some document checks that you'll need to undergo in order to get access to the apprenticeship funding. So it sounds like quite a daunting process, but the university applications will guide you through every step of the way. So the admissions team at NTU deal with both apprenticeship applications and undergraduate applications. So they know what we need for each one of those applications, and we'll be able to help you through every step of the way from the moment that you start filling in that application right through to enrollment.
Thanks, Amy. That's really helpful. And I think NTU sounds like you've got quite a relatively streamlined process for that. It won't be the case at every different university. So I think if you are interested in an apprenticeship or a degree apprenticeship, you'll have to use your initiative again, do a lot of research on that. But equally, you can also apply with a UCAS application for a traditional undergraduate degree alongside any apprenticeship applications. You can do that. So don't feel like you have to choose one or the other. Obviously, once you get your results and once you get your place confirmed through UCAS or indeed your apprenticeship, you'll then have to choose, because it'll be quite difficult for you to be in two places at once. But that might be something that you want to keep as your, keep your options open. But it does require quite a lot of effort, particularly with the apprenticeship application. You may need to do additional checks, as Amy said, because you're going into paid employment as well as learning. It's different to going straight into a higher education undergraduate degree course. But definitely keep your options open. UCAS has got loads and loads of information about apprenticeships as well as applying to uni. So have a look. Have a browse, all of that information is available from your Hub account. Okay, so we've touched briefly on the personal statement, Charlie. You talked about it. So we're thinking about the rest of the application, these extracurricular activities that people could do, volunteering, work experience, etc. How much focus should you put on the personal statement compared to the rest of the application?
So the personal statement plays an important part of the application. There's no getting away from that. It's there for a reason. It's there for universities to help decide who they're going to make offers to. But it's also there for the students to use as an exercise, almost kind of validating the decisions and the choices that they're making. So personal statement is absolutely important. We looked at alongside the other parts of the application. So I think it's important that students focus on it. They make sure that they are providing a good account of themselves within the statement, but the other sections in the application will also be important. The education section where you're providing your educational history, or students find their educational history, is clearly important. Applying for an academic course, your academic performance and history is going to be looked at and used by universities when making decisions on individual applications. Does that answer your question?
I think so, yeah. And I suppose the personal statement is important in that if you've done these extracurricular activities, the personal statement will bring that to life, won't it?
Absolutely. The personal statement is a place for you to provide evidence that you are, you've done these things. So it could be that you've attended a summer school, could be that you've done work experience, could be that you've had a part-time job. It could be, you know, anything at all which is relevant to the application could be included within your statement and will be looked at, particularly for students who are applying for very competitive courses where students might be predicted the same grades, might have the same GCSE attainment. That could be the point of difference in an application. So it absolutely needs to be focused on. And
yeah, wonderful. Thank you. So Amy, we'll come to you for this next question because it links to the apprenticeship piece as well. And I know that at Bath that you don't run apprenticeships, so Charlie probably wouldn't be able to help too much on that.
At the moment.
For now. So in terms of the application, in brackets S, with the two different routes, do they have to be completed all in one go?
No, absolutely not. So starting with undergraduate applications, you can save and come back to it as and when you want to. Just make sure that you're mindful of the deadlines for submission. So 15th of October for Oxford, Cambridge, medicine, dentistry, vet medicine. But then also the 25th of January for all other applications, 25th of January 2023 is the equal consideration deadline. So you don't have to complete your application all in one go, but just make sure you submit it by that deadline. With apprenticeship applications, as Courtney's already said, it will vary by university. But with our apprenticeship applications at NTU, you can save partway through and come back to it later on. But again, just make sure you're monitoring the deadlines and that you have got plenty of time to get it all finished and all submitted by that deadline.
I think that's really helpful, particularly for the undergraduate application. You can do it in bits, so you can save it and go along. But ahead of those important deadlines, make sure you know what you have to do as well. So with the undergraduate application, you have to have your reference completed as well before you can submit your application. Now, that's really important. If you're doing your application together with your school, they'll do that reference for you. Yeah. They still need to submit your application on time. If you are applying independently and you're not linked with a school or a registered centre, then that reference, whoever you've asked to do your reference, will need to complete that for you as well. That has to be received by UCAS on your UCAS application, and then you can submit it. You'll miss the deadline if those references aren't completed by then. And of course, if you miss the deadline, then you aren't able to be considered equally amongst all the other people. So it's much, much more important for you to focus on the different aspects of your application to be done by that deadline, as well as giving yourself plenty of time. And speaking from a lot of personal experience, speaking to lots of students who've been in that same boat, make sure you know what you need to do before submitting your application. Okay, so we'll stay with you, Amy, on this one, and then move to Charlie on the last question. So predicted grades is it's quite apt at the moment, isn't it, with a lot of students starting to sit their exams, or maybe you've already completed your exams. So in the back of your mind, you'll be wondering, did you meet the predicted grades? Were the predicted grades accurate? But question for you, Amy, working at the university, is how important are predicted grades when looking at a UCAS application?
Yeah, so we do look at predicted grades, obviously, when we're assessing applications to check that not only the qualifications that you're taking, but also in some cases what subjects you're taking. So, for example, if you wanted to apply for a science subject at NTU, it's likely that you would need to be doing a science subject at A-level. So we use predicted grades as part of that check-in. When it comes to both offer making and then final decision making, so when we get all the results, we assess your application against the offer that we make to you. So if you're predicted AAA but your offer is BBB and you achieve BBB, then what we're looking for is that BBB against the offer that we've made to you. So it doesn't matter from that perspective if you don't meet the predicted grades, because you've met the conditions of the offer. That's the important part for us that you need to meet. So yes, we use the predicted grades to make sure that, you know, people are at a specific standard, but when it comes to making final unconditional offers, it is comparing your achieved grades against that offer that we've made and not your predicted grades. So don't panic, particularly on results day, if you haven't met your predicted grades, but you have met the conditions of your offer, or even if you don't think you've met the conditions of your offer, you need to log on to UCAS Hub and see what the decisions that the universities have made are against your application. So don't just assume because you haven't got what you were predicted that we're not going to be able to make that decision for you.
That's really important. Thanks, Amy. So, Charlie, from your perspective, anything to add around predicted grades and advice to students who might be worrying too much about those?
My advice would be speak to the teachers or advisors who are supporting you with the predicted grades and make sure that you've kind of joined up thinking. Predicted grades, as the name says, are one thing that universities look at, but we'll also look at a variety of other things. So don't focus too much on them. Focus on things you can control, like your personal statement, like doing well in your actual attainment and exams and coursework throughout your final year in school and college. And then the rest will hopefully kind of take care of itself. But it is a good idea to have a conversation with the people providing your predicted grades, particularly if you're applying for things that you perhaps haven't spoken to them about before, and so that your teachers can support your application in the right way.
Okay, that's good to know. So those predicted grades, they probably will have been assigned and submitted with you along with your UCAS application way back when you first submitted it. So that might have been October, might have been January. Where you are now is focusing on your exams. If you're writing your exams next year, then do the best you can so that A, you get the best predicted grades you can possibly get, but also you put in the hard work now. That means when you do write those exams, you should be in a good place to hopefully get that high attainment based on what it is you want to go and do. So the final question here for you, Charlie, is around references. So we've talked about a bit about references. Would you be able to briefly explain what references are used for? And then also, who can write your reference if you're no longer at a school or college?
Okay. So I'll start with the second part of the question first of all. So references are usually provided by a school or college that students are applying from. If, for whatever reason, students not able to get a reference from their current school or college, then we would say that you can get a reference maybe from an employer or somebody else that knows you in a professional context. We can't accept references from family members or close friends of an applicant, but somebody who's able to kind of validate, for want of a better word, the rest of your application and to endorse your application and support what you've included elsewhere. Sorry, what was the other
one? So the other one was around a brief summary of what is the reference used for?
So the reference is used by admissions teams to, I guess, validate sometimes context or information contained within a personal statement. Sometimes a reference might be used to tell us about, extenuating circumstances that an applicant might have experienced. It could be that they are putting the achievement in context for a student. So the reference is absolutely important. It will be looked at by admissions teams when selecting or deciding who to make offers to. Students, but I would say the kind of personal statement, the grades are equally as important, and the reference should be a complement to that rather than sort of supporting that, boosting that, if that makes sense.
Absolutely, thank you. And Amy, from the point of view of an application for an apprenticeship, is that reference different to one that might be provided or put forward for a UCAS application?
Not necessarily. So if you are applying for a degree apprenticeship straight out of school or college, then you can use a reference from your school or college to apply for a degree apprenticeship. That's not a problem at all. But if you have got a more relevant reference or what you think is a more relevant reference, so if, for example, you're already working for a company and you want to do a degree apprenticeship with that company, you may be able to get an employer reference to support your degree apprenticeship application that could be more relevant than an academic reference, particularly if you've been out of school or college, as you said in the first question. You can look at other references that may be more appropriate for the course that you're applying for. Mm-hmm. But generally, we're looking for the same information, so it is that secondary validation essentially of the application. So you get the opportunity to tell us all about yourself in your personal statement. We have all the information about your qualifications and summer schools and all of those other things that you've done, and then the reference is the final part, if you like, that is validating what you're saying. So if you're applying from a school or college, it will validate your predicted grades. And if you're not applying straight out of school or college, then it says something about you as a person and your suitability to study either undergraduate courses or a degree apprenticeship.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you both. I think that's given some good colour around what the kinds of things you could do to really enhance your application, really make it sing over and above the standard information that you can include. So as we always do with these sessions, we'll have a final home takeaway key point from each of the panellists for this. So I'll go to you, Charlie, to begin with. Now, with the context of everything we've spoken about, whether it's apprenticeships or work experience, volunteering, summer schools, what's your key takeaway for someone who wants to lift their application over and above the standard stuff?
So I would say try and be as authentic as possible when you're writing your statement, when you're pulling together your application. And there's lots of advice that, you know, I and Amy have offered today. But what we're looking for is that kind of personal touch. So it could be that you've done work experience. It could just be that you've had a lived experience of, I don't know, a mental health condition, which has led you to choose the course that you're doing. It could be that a sibling has gone through an experience which has inspired your kind of your choice. So there's lots of advice and things to include, but you can include anything you want. We often get questions, you know, should I include this? Can I include that? You can include whatever you want. As long as you can articulate why you're including it and why it's relevant to your application, that's the main thing. And yeah, don't be afraid to, you know, add a bit of personal touch, be authentic, and include whatever you think is going to make your application stronger.
Fantastic advice. Thank you, Charlie. Amy, so that's some good advice from Charlie. How are you going to top that one?
That's brilliant advice. I think the only thing that I would add would be your point from earlier, Courtney, about taking your time with the application process, whether it's the undergraduate application process or under-degree apprenticeship. Take your time when filling in that application form, but make sure that it doesn't come as a surprise to you what's coming next. So if you do leave it until, let's say the 18th of January, no one's going to leave it until the 25th. If you leave it until late and you are surprised that you need to submit a reference and make the payment and do all of these other things in order to submit it, then you need to make sure you're not in that position. So really take your time, make sure you know the application process inside and out, and then you can concentrate on the important parts of the application from your perspective. So getting the information accurate that you're entering, but then also focusing on that personal touch. So your personal statement, spending some time doing drafts of that and getting all the information together in order to write that piece of work. Better to spend time doing that than panicking about having to find your reference right at the very last minute.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Okay, so what I got from that, three main takeaways, I think. So we've got authenticity, to Charlie's point. So if you're going to go and do work experience, summer school, volunteering, make sure that's you and that resonates with you and who you are as a person, as well as what you want to go on and do. Initiative. Take the initiative to go look for these different opportunities because they are out there, but they're not going to be put on a plate in front of you. You need to go and look for them. And then thirdly is give yourself time. We talk about this a lot on all of these sessions you'll hear from the UCAS, through the UCAS Hub. Give yourself time. It's a really important decision that you're going into, whether it's applying for an apprenticeship or university or both, that will shape the future of your life. So give yourself time on that. You don't want to be rushed into doing something that you may regret later on in the future. So thank you, Charlie. Thank you, Amy, for being here with us today. Some really fantastic advice that I hope everybody watching has taken on board, and they'll be starting their application well ahead of time and going about with all their research to make the application really, really sing. So thanks for having us, and we'll see you on the next Hub Live when we next get there. So thanks, everybody. Take care. Bye now.